Hello and welcome to Avid Carpers, a brand new concept feature length film featuring lots of big carp with some really good anglers. And we're going to kick things off today with none other than top data kit angler Mark Bartlett, who's fishing at long range on the prolific linear fisheries.
Well, welcome to Braze News One. I'm at the linear fisheries complex and you join me fishing this water where I'm going to be looking at fishing at long range and how I just sort of go about it and get the best use, you know, all of my little tips and tricks for fishing out at distance. And the cameraman's just turned up in true fashion. Well, as he turned up, I was just playing the last of three fish that I've caught recently. So I'm going to get these out, get some really nice photographs, get them back, and then we can get into the session and look at exactly what I'm up to. That's a chunky one, 34 pounds. Yeah, the most recent fish. The last one of the three that adds rocked up whilst I was playing. Proper braze nose carp, this one. Right, little chunky monkey. Cheers, buddy. There you go. 31 pounds. Nice mirror. Well, there you go. Pick of the bunch for me so far, this one. A little over 32 pounds. Third 30 on the bounce out of five fish this morning. Absolutely flying start. But yeah, just goes to show that we're doing something right. So I'm going to get this one back after a few photos and then we can run through exactly the ins and outs of this session, what we're going to be doing, how we're going to be doing it. Hopefully get yourself a few of these. It's just up at the bivvy having that cup of tea that I was on about. A well-earned brew. The old left-hander's pulled up tight and she was away. Happy days. I'm not complaining. I was sat there last night and I reckon I seen about 3.7 gazillion carp up the other end of the lake. And I was contemplating moving, to be honest. And I sat on my laurels. Come good this morning and they've moved down the lake, and there's just a few fish where they were like really condensed up the top end. They've come down and they've sort of, looks like they've spread out a little bit and we've got one. So yeah, happy days. Typical long range bite. A lot of the time, you know, you don't get like absolute rippers, and I'm a nightmare for fishing quite a tight clutch as well. Because obviously you've got loads of line out, loads of strip, like, you know, the fish has got plenty of cushion in the length of the line that you've got out in the water. So I fish quite tight clutches, and normally it's a couple of bleeps, it pulls up tight and that's as much as it's gonna get, and then I'm on the rod and job's a good one. Yeah, nice to get into a couple of fish there. Like I say, this lake is absolutely brilliant as well for just like the average size of the fish. You know, this is, I don't know obviously what's on the end of here, but that five fish already and a trio of 30 pounders. You cannot grumble at that. That, you know, they're They're a good sized fish, and I dread to think what's actually swimming around in this lake. I know there's like one definite 50. I'm pretty sure there's another fish that's fairly close to that, along with probably anywhere from the sort of, well, at the right time of year, 15 to 20, 40 pounders, which is why it's an absolute mega place to fish. And like, I'm not even going to mention the 30s, obviously. There are a lot of 30 pounders in here. Number 6 in the bag. Yeah, beautiful. Let's get him out. Get that rod back out. There could be a couple about now. I'm buzzing. There's a few fish, you know, they've come down the lake. This could be the start of a few fish, which is typical in Braze News fashion. Once they're on you, they're on you, and there's you know, more than that. So let's get it sorted out. Well, I've just unhooked that lovely 20 pound carp, and I had a fresh rig up in the bivvy ready to rock and roll. So I thought I'd hook it on, get this rod straight back out, because where there's one, there's two. And it just gives me a good opportunity just to sort of have a little run through of the hardware that I'm going to be using for this session. And the rods that I'll be using are the 13 foot elevates in 3 3/4. For me, the rod is probably the most important. It's the most important tool of the job for fishing or carp fishing at long range. This rod, it's got a lovely fast recovery. It's got some nice, strong three-legged guides, like K guides. So you don't get any dramas with line frapping or shock leaders wrapping around the butt grip. And for me, that's massively important. And then secondly, just coupling it with a nice size reel. Got an ACR 12,000 on this. I've got 10 pound outline camo and a tapered monofilament shock leader, which I'll go through in a bit more depth further into the session. But yeah, that's the hardware. Let's get the business end out in the pond, see if we can catch another fish. That's the line nice and tight. And there's a couple of things I do when I'm distance fishing. The first one is to make sure that you got the rod pointing straight at where you're aiming. And this also gives you, well, two reasons. One, once you aim your middle rod at where you're, you know, where you're fishing, if you've ever in the night, you got, I don't know, you wipe all your rods out and you want to recast, you can cast out to where you think it is. And if you look parallel, dead straight down the rod, and that's where your spot is, you know that you ain't never going to be too far away, because if you can't see your far bank marker or something, it's a good, you know, it's a good starting point to get you out of trouble. Secondly, make sure you use a nice heavy bobbin, keep your line as tight as you possibly can, and I like the clutch just so it can just take line before sliding the rod forwards. For me, that's, you know, you've got so much mono out in the pond anyway, you don't need a very loose clutch at all. And that's pretty much it, really. Once the rod's set in position, these three rods are back on the dance floor, as they say. Let's have a look at that fish and get that one slipped back. And then we can regroup and go again. Not a lot more's happened since that last fish. I was expecting another bite, to be honest. A couple showed, but I've not seen anything for a while. However, it's gone out. It's freezing anyway, but not freezing, but it is getting on to being pretty cold. I just rocked the old heater out. I didn't know whether to bring it this session. I thought, shall I? I thought, yeah, go on, get it in the van. So I've got a little heater, chucked it in the van. I've even brought the hot water bottle, but it's not quite that bad yet. But yeah, could be on the cards, the way the weather's dropping in. It's meant to be, like, it said it was going to be cold, and Oxford's always got his own little weather climate. It's like 10, 12 degrees back at mine. It's normally about minus 24 here. So yeah, we always come prepared. I think it's just something that I get from the old Lynch days, fishing there in the winter, and the lake's half frozen all the time. It's a long time getting cold, so you go well prepared. Well, absolutely written off now. We've had some food and I think we've overdone it a little bit. I think it was the chocolate fudge cake and cream at the end. Just tipped me over the edge. Now, I mean, it's up to the fish a bit now. The rods are out. They're on the dance floor. Nice and tidy. Bit of bait over the top. And yeah, if there's anything to go by, you know, by today, then like the sort of early mid-morning is the time to be catching them. We have heard a few, and when it arrived, I didn't think I was going to catch anything because obviously all the fish were like miles. I couldn't have been any further away from the fish. Whereas I've actually heard a few out here tonight. I've only heard sort of three or four in the last hour, but it's three or four more than I've heard before then. So yeah, fingers crossed. I don't know what time I'll be seeing you. It could be in the morning. But I'm going to go and get into a food coma. Have a nice snooze because it's actually pretty nippy. It's pretty cold. So yeah, if I don't see you with a fish, I'll see you in the morning. It's finally rattled off. Took a lot longer than I thought. It is almost daylight. I reckon we've got about another 20 minutes before it actually gets light. And yeah, had a good night's kip though. I know I've had a good night's kip because my little dangler's feels a bit swollen. I think I might have been cutting a few logs last night. But yeah, that was a good fish. Nice, it's finally gone. I was expecting a bit of a quicker bite, really. There was a few fish in the area. Gonna have to hang on in here. This one was a little bit bigger than I thought. 36.5 pounds, which is exactly why I come here long range carp fishing, because you can get yourself a good stamp of lovely big carp. So we've had 7 carp now, and this is the 4th one over 30 pounds, which I'm sure you'll agree is a blooming good average to catch 30 pound carp. Yeah, but you get the tactics right, get the rigs right. And on a lake like this, these aren't that far away. You just got to apply it nice and neatly. Get yourself a few bites and catch some stonking gert carp like this one. Lovely. Get a few snaps, get her back. Or get him back, should I say. We've seen that it's a boy on the mat. Yeah. Nice male carp. Get on. Just getting this rod ready to rock and roll. And I mentioned sort of briefly that I was using a tapered mono leader line. And these are the outline camo ones, and they go from 12 pounds to 35 pounds over sort of roughly four rod lengths, which gives you a really nice transition from your main line down to a much heavier section towards the lead. And I really like these. I think that, you know, they just offer a really nice presentation. And these fish in here, they get fished for an awful lot. I think they see a lot of braided leaders, because obviously for distance fishing, a braided leader is probably the best leader you can use in terms of range. But for here, where I'm only fishing 30 rod lengths, it's not, you know, it's not necessary to have a braided leader. I can use these monofilament leaders and they're absolutely perfect. So I just think that offers me a little bit better presentation and concealment with my main line. And then I've just got that down to a naked tail rubber, so I haven't got any tubing. The reason why I haven't got any tubing is because I was unsure whether I was going to be fishing on the bottom, because sometimes here you can catch a lot of fish on zigs as well. So having this just covers me for both options. So I've got a naked tail rubber to a quick change leg clip. And then you can see my little anti-tangle sleeve, 4.5 ounce distance lead. And then probably the most important thing about distance fishing is having a no-nonsense anti-tangle hook length. The more stuff you put on your hook length for fishing distance is the more that can go wrong. If you've got blobs of putty and swivels and stuff like that, you know, like coated sections, uncoated sections, to me, it's just nonsense that is potentially going to offer a tangle, especially when you're fishing at range. You know, when you're fishing short, you can see your hook length all the way out. When you cast at distance, it gets so far out and then you can't really see anything. So for me, just a simple D-rig. And the most important thing about your hook length is your hook. Fishing at range, you're going to have that carp on the end of your line for a long period of time. So you want to make sure you've got a nice, strong hook. So here, I've got a size 6 snag hook. I got no worries whether I was using a 6 or a 4. I'm using a 6 on this one just because it perfectly matches my hook bait, which is a little grain of orange corn with a dozen or so maggots on the top. And this has actually been the sort of best rig for the bites, the orange hook bait. Normally, I mean, I dread to think how many carp I've caught out of this lake on, you know, like a little PB wafter or a little PB pop-up tip with a few maggots, you know, a nice yellow hook bait. But there's actually quite a lot of color in the water at the moment because of the winds that we've had. And I think that this orange is just standing out that little bit more due to the color in the water. And I think that's what's just made this rig catch a few more than the other colors. I have been fishing with a yellow one with a few maggots on the top, and also a little bug wafter where I've just put like two worms on the top just to match the pellets that I've been feeding, along with the corn and a little bit of chop worm. And yeah, that is the rig. Now it's time to get it back out in the drink. Well, I'm about to chuck this rod out, and it's a good time to just go through with you on like fishing at distance. If you're a little bit unsure, I'm sure there's plenty of people that know how to fish long range. I'm not trying to tell anyone how to suck eggs or anything like that. But I've spent an awful long time when I was a little kid, just casting at lemonade bottles up the field, just casting, see how far I could cast. And a lot of it does boil down to a bit of practice. But if you're a little bit unsure of sort of just how to make a start on it, then a great, well, a few little tips in that is, firstly, getting the right drop. I've got a 45 degree angle on my rod, and as I look through the butt ring, I can see the lead just in line with the ring. That gives me a really decent drop. Obviously, if you're fishing on a really steep bank, you might have to shorten your drop a little bit, but it's a great starting point. And then start with the rod down and turn the rod up. That way, I know that I can feel with my finger that that line is running through those rings nicely. And it's a good point here, but I've always got my reel set nicely, the spool down against the bottom of the shaft, and that way the line can come off the spool really nicely onto my finger. And probably the most important bit is just getting the rod up. You don't want the rod like down here or like cooped up. Get the rod up above you. You know, you're gonna be using a big tool to cast the fishing weight a long way. And if you can get the rod up above your head, you've got a lot more to play with. You can really get the, you know, get the rod to do the work for you, and that's what you want. You get, you know, you're using a tool to do the job for you. So you can look through your butt, like through the handle, what you're aiming at. And one of my biggest things is not looking at the water's edge. I always try and look up, top of a tree, top of a pylon, whatever I'm aiming at, something that I can see. You know, for all my fishing, I've always try to fish towards something that I'm going to see all the time, day and night. If you're trying to get those rods back out catching a lot of fish, you want to be able to put that rod back on that spot at any time. So get the rod nice and high above you, and that way when you come back with the cast, you can come right back to here and get plenty of power in the rod. And then take your aim, and then just a nice simple one. It's just what I call like a little one step. So as you step forwards, you can then release the cast. So it's just back, one step, punch, and out it goes. You can see how easy that is at the clip. And yeah, it's a very simple way of casting. It's a fishing cast. It's not like any tournament cast or what you'd do if you were casting on a field. This is a very, just a basic, good long range fishing cast. Well, that's the three rods back on the dance floor. And yeah, we're in the lap of the carp at the moment. I have just seen a fish show right down to the left, which wherever they've moved down there, maybe that's why it's a little bit quiet or gone quiet. Still, I've had a great session so far. 7 fish, 4 30 pounders up to just over 36, which is not bad. Proper bit of autumn fishing, and typical the results of fishing out in the middle of the pond this time of year. So yeah, I'm gonna sit here and see if I can see a few more Bosch. I'm just about to slip some more bait out for the evening. It's been a bit quiet, so I thought I'm gonna top up just before it gets dark. And now's a good time to talk to you exactly the hardware that I got for doing that. And it's basically a matching spotter marker rod. So it's a 13 foot Elevate spotter marker rod. I've got an XR Pro spod reel. So I've got a nice heavy duty reel for fast retrieve. So obviously I'm casting a long way. You wanna get that spod or your lead in and out when you're plumbing up as fast as you can. On here, I've got some extremity spod braid. So a nice thin braid for long range fishing. And then I've got a 50 pound shock type braided shock leader for spodding. I would never use a mono shock leader for spod or marker floating. It's always a braided main, like a braided line for that. I've got my white MIDI X spon, so a nice sort of in-between size. So it's gonna fly out there. It's a really nice, you know, it's a really nice size, the MIDI X spon for that sort of range. And then the mix I've got is sort of quite a nice mix for distance fishing. I've got a few pellets, and then I've got some corn. Like, corn's obviously really heavy. And in there I've got a bit of bug meal, which absolutely stinks as well. And I've just coated the pellets. I've coated the pellets in a bit of bug food liquid. There you go, you see it, the clip there, really easy. Could've probably gone about another 40 yards. Yeah, so I've coated the pellets in a bit of bug food liquid just to stick that bug meal to the pellets. So that'll make it really nice and heavy with the corn. Got a handful of chopped worm in there as well. And yeah, that's it. Nice bit of food for them for this evening. Hopefully encourage a couple of bites. It's been really quiet all around the lake today. Hardly a fish showing. You know, as far as I'm aware, the only fish that's been caught is the one that I've caught earlier on. Good morning. Quiet night last night. There's not been hardly a fish caught around the lake, as far as I believe, after speaking to the bailiffs and that. And there's not a lot showing either. It doesn't look great. I think those easterly winds have really knocked the fishing on the head a little bit. But I have seen two fish pop out in the middle, and a great long range tactic is the trusty old solid bag. It's caught me plenty of fish. And it's great, especially if you're fishing sort of beyond, you know, further than what you could chuck a spod or a spom, then this is a lovely little parcel of food and can sometimes get you out of trouble pretty quickly. And yeah, I'm gonna lob this to where I've seen those fish show in the middle. Just see what happens. Well, there you go. That is out in the middle of the drink. Nice flick. It's actually really easy to flick it long range with these rods. I've got to be a little bit careful how far it goes. I don't want it going over into someone else's water, but that is bang in the middle of the lake. Just see if there's a few fish traveling down that middle. Like, you can imagine from either side, everybody's fishing. Like, it's a busy old lake, this, but a lot of people can sort of spod between, I'd say, like 80 and 120 yards. And that sort of 30 yard strip down the middle can often just be like a little resting area for the fish. There's not many people that are gonna come here and spot it up at 33, 34 rod lengths every day of the week. You know, you might get the odd angler that can fish that far out. So I think sometimes those fish take advantage of that little bit of space off the back of all the commotion. So we'll see if that does us a bite. Well, Well, that's me, all done and dusted. Last rod to chuck in the van. And yeah, lovely session I've had. Four nice big 30 pounders. So make sure you get yourself down here and have a go for these big brazenose carp. And it just goes to show that fishing those extra few yards out can be the difference sometimes, can get you those few extra bites. Hope you've enjoyed the video, that you can take something from it, put it into your own fishing, and most importantly of all, enjoy your fishing. See you soon.
Well, what a great session that was for Bart over at Linear Fisheries. Some lovely 30 pounders, all at long range. And now we go from that long range fishing in Oxfordshire over to Cambridgeshire, home fen, home with some massive carp, where we join Paul Heseltine, who I believe has got a 40 pounder in the net.
Hello and welcome to Holme Fen Fishery. Now currently as we speak, I've done a night already and we're rolling into the afternoon. And just not long ago, I had my first bite and I'm absolutely buzzing about that because I just rung the cameraman. He was 10 minutes away and he was blasting down the road to get here. So I've got one in the retainer to show you and it looks like quite a good one. So yeah, while I get myself sorted because I haven't got the rod back out yet, you can have a look at the fight footage and then we'll have a look at the fish.
Come to daddy. Oh, it's not bad. It's not bad. That'll do. That'll do, mate. It settled the nerves. I was getting worried. I was thinking about moving, to be quite honest. Oh, it's not a big one. I don't look it anyway. I don't know. The things that you go through. Only a 30 pounder.
Go look, 41 pound to start off the session with. Absolute lovely fish. They're like peas in a pod in here, these fish, around the 40 pound mark. But believe it or not, there's some bigger fish out there. So now I'm gonna get that rod back out. The sun's just setting. Hopefully I'm gonna sit back, have a brew, watch the sunset. If I don't have a bite this evening, I shall see you in the morning. Go tell granddad or nanny that I want to catch it. Well, good morning, and unfortunately, it's not quite a good morning. I did get a bit of action last night. To cut a long story short, I got a fish stuck in the weed and it was completely solid. It was a really good bite as well, bobbing pulled up, but you could tell it was in weed straight away. As it went off, I just pulled it back into the weed bed. couple of mates come up to help me, and they actually waded my rod round this bay to the other side of the lake, and I met them round there, come into contact with the fish again, managed to free it, and it turned out to be a tench. I was not a happy angler at that point. I feel like I'd smashed the swim to pieces, head torches everywhere, and then it's a tench. Bit embarrassing, if I'm honest. When I come back round, I just leant the rod against the bivvy and got into bed. The commotion, it took a couple of hours, all that commotion of actually from start to finish. So this morning, I've got the rod back out. So far, it doesn't look good for a bite, but it's not over until the fat lady sings, as they say. I had that bite yesterday afternoon, literally 10 minutes before the cameraman got here, and I think that was 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna sit on the rods, I'm gonna make some breakfast, and then we'll have a little bit of look at what I'm doing. Well, we're approaching the afternoon now, and I'm getting a little bit concerned about the amount of bait that's on the spot. I've had a few coots pick me up, and not only that, I've had a tench on the middle rod. But we're approaching that time where I'm expecting a bite on the left-hand rod, certainly to go by from yesterday. So I'm gonna take this opportunity to run through the bait, because I'm just about to send a boat out there and drop some more bait. So what I'm doing is I'm crumbing up a lot of bait. Now in here, I've got the Maxi Nut. It's a very good boilie, that, from Key Bait Solutions. And I've also got some of the pellet range to go with it. I've got the ASM, and I've also got the Maxi Nut pellet. And what I am doing is I'm finishing it off with a little bit of liquid. I've got a little bit of hemp oil here, which I've been putting on my particle. But I'll start off with how I've been doing it. I use the crumb to plug the bottom of the boat. So a good sprinkling of that. So that's in there to plug the bottom of the boat. Nothing's going to escape out the sides, because I'm worried about the hemp coming out or getting caught in the hopper. Sometimes you do get that. And in this mix here, this is from Midland Mixes. I got some hemp and maize from them. So I am finishing it off with a good helping of particle. That is the main body of the feed out there. I do believe that these bigger fish that swim in here like to pick up them smaller pieces. So that's my mix. Apart from adding a little bit of liquid, I mean, this is the syrup. I would add a bit of glug on top, so we'll do that. And that is it. That is literally it. So that's the mix. I'm going to get that out there now and see if I can't make a bite happen. Right then, evening is fast approaching at the moment, and unfortunately not a lot has happened today, but that is the way on this type of water, I will say that. We did have some occurrence with the tench picking me up and the birds picking me up, so I've redone them two rods. They are sitting perfect, but that right hand rod, that's been sat out there for God knows how long, and it's got weed bending it all over the place at the moment, so I need to redo that before I sit back for this evening to see what occurs. So I'm going to whip this right hand rod in now, and hopefully this evening we can make something happen. See, that's that kelp weed. It's real brutal stuff. You know, you imagine that strand there that I've just pulled in, the roots at the bottom, and that's, well, that's 6 foot long, that piece there. Can you imagine what that does? Yeah, it's not exactly fisherman friendly, let's say. That's why we call it the kelp weed. I'm going to switch this rig over now, over to a bigger hook. I'm going to go up to the size 4 Amarok curves. I just know that these little pink pop-ups sit perfectly off of that hook like a wafter, and that'll sit flat on the deck. And then anything I do hook, I've got a chance of landing it through this weed. So that's the rig there, sitting perfectly. Let's just hope that that's going to do the business for us tonight, and it's going to be a big fat carp on the bank. Let's get it out there. Good morning. Not a lot of positive to report on this morning. The weather's taken a turn for the worse, and we are actually bivy bound at the moment. I don't know if you can hear the wind and the rain, but it feels very much more autumnal, let's put it that way. Other than that, a coot's wiped out one of my rods already. Currently I've only got two rods sitting out there, but they are the money rods. But it is one of them waters where you've just got to sit on your hands and wait for something to happen. So I'm gonna at least see if I can sort of wait out the worst of this weather before I get that other rod back out there. And then we'll shall have a little bit of an update in a bit. Little bit more time's passed now, and I'm thinking about getting that rod back out there, which got cooted this morning. So I'm going to take this opportunity to run through the rig in a little bit more detail. So there we've got some rig tubing. That's our outline camo rig tubing, which rule stipulate here. That's going down to one of our quick change lead clips and also one of our tail rubbers. That then goes down to a quick change system. As I'm fishing a loop, I've got one of our XL anti-tangle sleeves. That there is 35-pound captive coated hook link. And I'm fishing it multi-style, and I've opted to use one of our Ronnie rig sleeves. I prefer the Ronnie rig sleeve because I find it a lot more easier to change the hook quickly when I need to. And that there is one of our size 4 Amarok curve hooks. Hook bait wise, that there is actually a 10mm topper. It's a pop up. It actually sits flat, as we've mentioned, the hook flat just sits up perfectly under the weight of the hook. I'm going to get that back out there right now and see if we can't make something happen before the cameraman has to go. We're fast running out of time now. Right then, the session is just about to come to an end. Unfortunately, the cameraman cannot hang on any longer. However, it's not been a bad session. We did catch that lovely 40 pounder. What an absolute lovely fish that was. Real speckled scales down its flank and a nice chestnutty fish. But anyway, the eagle-eyed amongst you will notice that my stuff is still set up in the background, and that's because I'm staying on. But the cameraman has left me his GoPro, so I'm sure if I do have anything from now until then, you'll be seeing that footage now.
You will not believe it. I am 16 miles exactly away from the fishery. Just left Paul behind and he's phoned me up to tell me he's got a rather special one in the net. So it's time to turn this van round, head back and show you that one.
What's happened then, mate?
Oh, mate, cameramen get such about 10 minutes up the road. And Rob bursts off into action. Well, needless to say, there's a very, very big mirror sitting in my net right now, and I'm one happy carper again. And there we go, look, a breeze block of a carp, just gone 42 pound. And incidentally enough, it's the rod that did me the bite last time. I just can't catch why the cameraman's here by the looks of it. He's got to be either coming or going. But I'm gonna take some stills of this one now, and then we'll have another quick look before we go back. One last look before I send it off to the abyss. Oh, go on, Bobby. And that really is a wrap this time. And until next time, I shall see you on the next one.
What a lovely couple of fish they were from Holme. Well done to Paul. Great bit of fishing. And we now go from Cambridgeshire over to Essex, where we catch up with none other than former Olympic athlete Dean Macey, who's fishing at Blasford Hall. And I'm going to cast this rod out.
Well, welcome to Blasford Hill Fishery, a very cold Blasford Hill Fishery as well. The sun is literally just about to come up behind the trees. We don't have too many daylight hours. Unfortunately though, it's freezing cold today, bright sunshine, so it's gonna be scratching time, I would imagine. But Blasford's got a very good reputation for throwing up some decent fish through the colder months. And this is the type of fishing, carp fishing, that I do through the winter anyway. I don't session fish. I don't really set the house up for too long. I like to come out for a short day, hit it hard, stay on the move if I have to, and hopefully nick a few rewards. But under these mitts, I've got my fingers crossed. Let's get down there, because often the first hour of light is a very good time for a bite. I'm a poet and I don't know it. That might have been one. There's a few ducks around the edges, but I do know these carp like a margin in the morning and the evening. I've already flicked two rods out. This island here is the predominant feature in the lake, and in my experience, the first couple of hours, I've been in this swim before in very similar conditions, not really seen too much, although that might have actually been a fish over there. And I've been here and just catapulted a couple of 10 millers over the top of a tiny little bag of 10 millers and a sort of 10 or a 12 mil wafter, and it's done me a few bites. So didn't really see much this morning. That, however, has given me a very big feather in my cap, because it gives me something to go on. But like I said, two rods out by the island, probably got 30 or 40 10 millers over the top. When these fish are feeding, they're actually not shy of a boilie, so it's very nice fishing, and very simple fishing as well. But this one, my left-hand rod, I was thinking left or right. To be fair, I was waiting for a sign. That's as good a sign as I've seen. So I think what I'm going to do is, where they've actually chopped the bushes and the trees down, I'm going to be super stealthy and a little bit carpy. And I'm going to wander a rig round there. I'll probably actually take this hook link off, have a little donk around in the edge, just try and find the bottom of the slope, on here, it tends to be nice and gravelly right the way down to the bottom, and then just sort of a little bit softer. And I want to try and find that sort of, that crease between the two. Handful of 10 millers, simple rig, liner on my left hand rod. Fingers crossed. Right, let's get it done. Even doing much. I'm not entirely sure if it's a carp, you know. Really ain't doing much. Oh, and it is a carp. It's a carp. It ain't a bad one either. I think it's so bloody cold it didn't know what to do. Oh. I'm so hot. I've gone from freezing cold to literally thinking it's never going to happen to the most jittery, like, didn't want to take it bite, to thinking it was a tench or an eel or something, to now it's a... Well, I've got to say, that ain't far off 20 pound. And a 20 pounder on the conditions like this would be a marvellous result. And I don't even think it's midday. Bloody hell. Right, I am very keen to get this rod back out. I'm not entirely sure whether there's another fish down there to be had, but one of the reasons why we actually fished that swim is because earlier on this morning it was on the back of the wind and it was the only part of the lake that was in the sun. And if you're a cold-blooded carp, the one thing you want to do, if you are moving around, and we definitely saw fish moving this morning, is that you want to warm yourself up if you can possibly do it. So literally went and swung this rig under the rod tip just down there with a handful of 10 millers. Exactly the same rig and exactly the same method that I'm using out on the island, but in the edge. I'm fishing this rig naked, but to make sure that that sort of 2, maybe maximum 3 foot behind the lead is pinned down, I've just got a blob of putty just molded around the line. Got a tiny little sinker sort of thing just underneath there, which slides up and down. So it's really easy to move in case you have a crack off or anything. But most importantly, sometimes you just want it short, other times you want it long. So it's... It looks like they have turned up and getting liners on the island rods as well. That goes down to one of our naked towel rubbers, our leg clips, with a little anti-tangle boom. I've got a flat pair, a size 6 curve with one of our little aligner liners on there, and a barrel. As simple as that. Oh, and we've got supple hook link, which a lot of people turn their nose up at these days. I'm actually a really big fan of supple hook links because a lot of my fishing's done on either soft bottoms or in the margins. And I think if you've got a really nice, decent sinking supple hook link, if you're laying it in the edge or chucking it up tight to an island or in a soft bottom, it will lay over anything and it's just super supple. And in my mind, I really like the idea of having a hook link that's sort of curled up like a snake so that when the fish comes and picks your bait up, it flicks back into its mouth. I understand why people have the stiff booms, but I don't know. What works for me is what works for me. That's it, super simple. It's worked in the edge. Hopefully it works out to the island as well. We're starting to get a few liners, so hopefully this sun has warmed them up. Certainly warmed me up. I've had to take my hat off. I'm speaking really quickly as well because I want to get this rod back out, so excuse me. Right, this one's fished very close to the edge. probably only, from where the camera is, 3 foot. So I'm fishing semi-slack lines up to the island, trying to keep that last sort of rod length down so that they can mosey around and eat them 10 millers without getting disturbed. But here, everything pretty much from the rod tip to the lead, I want nice and slack, because with this sun on this quiet bay, I mean, when the wind picks up, it's very cold. It's not on the water at the moment, but I can imagine them swimming around this bay, just warming themselves up. And I don't want the line to be one of the reasons why they bugger off without eating. So you can almost not fish that slack enough, because when you're only a rod length from the tip and 3 foot from the bank, the bites, albeit the last one wasn't, the bites are normally pretty savage. There we go. Let's hope they just weren't that one there. There you go, what an absolute beauty. It's all about being in the right spot when you're winter carp fishing. And that's the trick, that is the key to the puzzle, trying to be in the right spot. And sometimes it takes a lot of trial and error, but like I said, the back of that bay with the sun on it, on the back of the wind, just looked absolutely prime for a carp that's cold in the winter that wants a warm up. And well, hopefully it's not the only one, but if it is, it's well worth a day out. Look at that, beautiful. Well, look at that. It might look lovely and sunny and summery, but trust me, that is a freezing cold winter 20, and I am very, very happy. Thank you very much. Oh, let's get another one. Well, looks a bit more fishy, doesn't it? But I can tell you, when that sun's gone in now, that has turned very, very cold. And it's been probably a couple of hours since I had that bite down the edge. I've had a few liners on the right-hand rod, and I feel like I probably should have had a bite off of it, if I'm honest. So after I finish talking to you, I'm going to have a rechuck. People always ask me when I should recast. And I feel like if you've set the traps perfectly and you get absolutely no indications through the day, there's probably no reason for you to, I mean, you can bait up over the top of them, but there's probably no reason for you to actually rechuck, simply because if it went out perfect, you're just trying to repeat that. And the odds are, if there's anything in the vicinity, you could probably spook them. But I think a perfect time to rechuck is if you get a few liners, a few indications, fish have definitely visited your spot and you don't get a pickup. Because for me, I feel like I had enough liners where I felt like I was going to get a bite, and where I didn't, something could possibly be wrong. So a few birds around, so they may have picked me up and just moved the rig a little bit. So I'm going to have a rechuck, simply because I feel like for the last hour and a half, that witching hour, I need in my mind everything to be perfect. And I'm not 100% sure that right hand rod is perfect. So I'm going to do that right now. Beautiful. That will go back out. Lovely. A lot of people worry about soft braided hook links. And I do understand, but the vast majority of the time, I'm just putting a tiny little bag on anyway, just to counteract any chance of a tangle. As long as you hit the clip or stop it and just straighten everything out just before it goes in, it should be absolutely mustard. And when we're chucking up tight to islands like this, not super tight, but right on the edge where twigs and in heavy wind, branches and stuff can fall off, at least I know that that is just sat over all of the debris nice and tight to the bottom. This sink's absolutely beautiful. So yeah, I had a few liners. I felt like this should have gone off. And as much as it came in absolutely perfectly, it's worth, just for the last couple of hours, for my peace of mind, getting it back out there nice and fresh. I'm hoping they revisit the spot. I think they will. Well, we ain't got much of light. We've probably only got an hour to go. And we've started seeing a few fish move, and one has just moved over the same spot that we saw one this morning, and that's the first time I've actually seen, so I'm looking at the bubbles right now, it's the first time I've actually seen either the same fish or two fish show on the same spot, so I don't want to take my eyes off of it. So I'm going to flick this rod straight over the top of it, tiny little bag, same hook baits, and see if it can do us a fish. Well, ladies and gents, it is 12 minutes past five and the gates close at 5:30, which means I've got to wind in. And when we were crunching down here through the frost this morning, if you'd have told me I'd have caught a scraper 20 common for the camera, I'd have been well happy. I genuinely would have done. But knowing that for probably 20 minutes today, I had fish feeding over my right hand rod up to the island and I couldn't convert it into a bite is a bit disappointing. But that's the great thing about short session fishing in the winter. I can go home, I can moan at the wife, tell her it's all her fault, and then in a few days' time, when the weather's a little bit better, I can come back and try and put all those wrongs right. So, but for now, we've got an uphill walk back to the van. Still got a fair bit to pack up, actually. The swim's a bit of a mess, and we've got to do it in a hurry. So, yeah, sort of thumbs up, thumbs down. It was an all right day. Very happy, actually.
Boy, it's cold here, but I've only gone and caught one. That's about that. Not too bad for up north, but let's rewind the clock to much warmer times and we go to the back end of summer, early autumn, and we head to one of the most iconic carp lakes in England. It really is a beautiful place, a venue known as Ashmead, really tough venue, and we're going to be with some dude called Screwy? Crewy? What's his name, Ad? Bloke?
Crowy.
Crowy? Crowy? Never heard of him. Some bloke called Crowy. Let's see how he gets on.
I think it's fairly safe to say that in more recent times, Ashmead has become one of England's most iconic carp waters. Not only does it contain some really special carp and some big carp as well, I think the lake record's about 58 pounds. It also is so unique with all of the little bays, the little islands. I've never seen a carp water like it, and I've fished an awful lot of venues all around the world and I've never seen anything like this place. It's really, really unique. It's very special as well. It's a long way from the commercial world of carp fishing that you see on lots of venues around the UK, because you come to somewhere like this, it's almost like going back in time. The years ago when I started carp fishing, it's a little bit like that, because all the swims are left untouched and you can be so far away from another angler, you're not aware that there's anybody else on here. So that's why I keep coming back here, and it's why lots of other anglers keep coming back here, because it gives you something different, something where it's you against the fish, and that every time you do catch a fish, it feels really rewarding as well. Whenever you fish on Ashmead, you have to do a draw for swims, and there's a maximum of 8 anglers allowed on the lake at any one time. So it's always a little bit of an exciting time doing the draw, but I ended up coming out 5th, so I didn't get my first choice of swim, but I did still get an half decent area. I ended up in a swim at the back of Gallops, the one of the little channels where there had been quite a few fish out of there over the last couple of weeks. So I was pretty confident because I had seen carp in that area as well, but it was a bit of a tight swim in that you just got like a channel moving out to the left and a channel to the right, so there wasn't a great deal of scope for me to move my rods around. But I ended up getting really lucky, because on my first night I caught a fish, well, the second morning I should say, after the first night, I caught a fish quite quickly. So just getting my first fish from Ashmead, especially when you drive so far from Yorkshire down to here, is always the goal. And I started things off with a 22 pound common, so we'll take a look at that fish now.
Oi oi, first morning and got one already, so yeah, proper chuffed. By the looks of it, it's a 20 plus common, so doesn't matter how big they are in this place though, it's always nice to get one. So Ashmead looking absolutely beautiful as always. Awesome. Let's take a look at it.
First morning and first carp, 22 pound common, so absolutely made up, because just being at Ashmead is what it's all about, and catching a carp, trust me, it's a bonus, it really is. Lovely.
The nature of Ashmead, with all these little bays and channels and stuff, would make you think that maybe the fish would spook out of an area quite quickly, but sometimes they do pass through there regularly, and the area that I was fishing those channels, the next day I started to see one or two carp still in there, so I decided to stay put and managed to catch myself another carp on the second day, and that was a 24 pound common, which came about 1:30 in the morning. And even then there was still carp in the swim, which I was quite surprised about. But the next day I managed to catch probably my milestone fish from here, because I always want to try and catch a certain size of fish when I go to a new venue. And with this being my second trip and my first trip not producing a 30 pounder, I thought, right, I'd love to get a 30 pounder from Ashmead. And on the third day, at 10:30 in the evening, I managed to catch a 31 pound common, which I was really chuffed with. Now that fish, it really did fight hard. It put up a good scrap and there was a lot of commotion in the swim. Lots of lights going off because of me doing a bit of video footage of it and stuff. And with Ashmead being quite a quiet venue, I did think that maybe those carp had moved out of that area the next day, because what I noticed was that the water had gone from being a little bit of a murky colour into a more of a clearer gin clear type of colour to it. So at the back of my mind, I was thinking about maybe moving swim. And what happens on Ashmead is after 3 days, some of the guys tend to leave, because you can book either for 3 days or for 6 days. And I knew that the guys that had been in North and South Goats had been catching quite a few fish. Old Bill Phillips had been on the lake. He'd had a 35 pound common and a 30 pounder from South Goats. But his mate James in North Goat had also had a 35 pound common and a 28. And with North Goat being my favorite swim on the lake, and if I'd come first in the draw, I'd definitely have chosen that swim. I decided to leave the area of the back channels and go into North Goat. And there are a few reasons for that. I know it might sound a bit bizarre moving out of a swim that's doing your bites regularly, but as I say, the nature of Ashmead is that if you do make a little bit of a noise, the chances are the fish are going to move out of there. And with that colour of the water changing slightly, I thought that was definitely the case. And with North Goat becoming available, it's a huge piece of water, North Goat is. There's loads of options. There's a chance to spread the rods around. And there's always carp passing through that area as well. It's kind of the heart, the central heart of this lake. And in that there's so many different arms and channels that lead off around into all the bays and other areas of the water. And also you've got the opportunity of fishing not just in North Goat itself, but you've actually got the chance of putting some rods over the back into the channels, into the square bay, where I know that one or two of the bigger fish have been caught in the past as well. So that's basically where we are now. I'm sat here in North Goat. I've not had anything from this swim yet, but I am definitely confident, because there's loads of opportunities and loads of chances to rove the rods around in this area if nothing happens. As the light fades on another autumnal evening at Ashmead, there is a sense of optimism in the air. Conditions feel right for those bigger fish to start making an appearance, and I'm convinced that someone around the lake is in for a surprise tonight. Fingers crossed, the move into North Goat pays off for me and I'm not left with my tail between my legs come the morning. Quiet, apart from the farmer. I'm not complaining, because the old boy's been doing his harvesting, which is hard work at this time of the year, so you wouldn't notice it if it was an area that was quite noisy, but this place is so quiet, you do hear the farmer. But yeah, all quiet on the rods, unfortunately. So lots of things going through my mind at the moment, because I've moved out of a swim that I'd done 3 nights in, had 3 fish, and then I moved into here
and not had anything. So yes, this is what happens when you fish somewhere like Ashmead, because there's so many back channels and so many areas where the fish migrate through and hide away that you're always sort of thinking in your mind, you know, you've got to stay on top of the fish, you've got to stay in tune with the fish as well. And you know, it's yeah, good thing about having a dog though is I'll definitely be doing some laps this morning and seeing if I can find the fish. But you know, this swim, the good thing about it is this is called North Goat. The good thing about this area is it's almost like the central part of the lake, really, the heart of the lake, because you've got all the channels leading into this area. And the few days I've been down here, it's done some big fish as well. There was a lad in here called James who had a 35 and a 28. And then South Goat, which is literally just behind this island, Bill Phillips, good old legend of carp fishing, been around a long time, Bill, and Ashmead regular as well. He also had a 35 and I think he had a 31 as well. So that's the reason why I came in here, because it's been doing big fish. And you just know with this time of the year that any moment soon somebody's going to get a big one. You know, that's why we're all down here, all the lads that are down here, they're all booked on for the 6 days. And they're all in knowing that there's big fish getting caught. I don't know exactly how many fish have been out whilst I've been here, but it's something like about 7 or 8 fish. And a large proportion of those have been over 30 pound as well. So yeah, something's gonna happen sooner or later. It's just a case of when and where, because you know, you've gotta find them, you've gotta track them down. So as soon as I've had my breakfast in a minute, probably after about 10 o'clock-ish, something like that, I know the dog will be wanting a walk, so I'll be doing the rounds, and whether I stay here or not is going to be decided by that. So yeah, decisions. Dunk away. Dunkin' Donuts. Can't beat them. Digestive in a coffee. Just having a walk round and seeing if I can see any fish. There's always a few knocking around in these little back channels. It always seems to be early afternoon when they start appearing. Sure, at other times of the year you probably see them all day, but certainly during this trip it's always been early afternoon, just as it starts to get a little bit warmer. So that's one of the good things about having a dog, is they've got a walker. This is the area where I started off from. Did 3 nights in here and had 3 fish as well. So to move out of there and to go into a new swim, yeah, a bit of a risk, so hope it pays off. Oh, it's just boshed. I was walking around, you just see the rings going out there. Something down here. And then the coots let out a toot toot like they do. Something's in this area.
Yeah, there's a few fish over the back there, mate, and that little pond there, I think they call it the square pond. There's a few over there, group of about 6 fish, and yeah, pretty decent fish as well. So when I redo my rods in a minute, I think I'm definitely gonna stick one over the back there. It's got to be worth a shout. Right, I need to be pretty stealthy now. So hopefully the dog will stay behind. Why is that like that? Alright, let's go and drop this in. Deciding when to put the bait out, because on water like this you can easily spook them out of the area if I make too much disturbance. That'll do. That'll definitely do. That's the blue rod. Don't let me forget, because in the middle of the night when you've been asleep for a few hours, you get that blaring take. Got rods spread all over the place. That's what happens at Ashmead. You've got one to the right, one in front of you, one down to the left. You've no idea which rod is going. So if the blue light goes, it's the one to the right. They've not been like this since I've been here in this bay. The very fact that they're here, they're going to be catchable. But you sit there thinking, I wish I got the rods in before they arrived. But I ain't spooked them anyway. If that rod's out, that's all right. It's whether to put another one in here or not. Those two rods moved into a new area, I was left with a sense of optimism following the disappointment of a blank night. And to my surprise, I didn't even have to wait long, as one of the rods I'd repositioned in the back channel let out a series of bleeps and we were into an Ashmead carp. I think you can tell there's loads of weed in this swim, so you need proper tough gear fishing in these kind of conditions. And at the moment, the old 15 pound outline, he's doing a sterling job for us. I think he's nearly there. Oh, the big load of weed. Let's get the weed as well, just to be sure. Yep, another one. Bit of a battle with the weed, but another Ashmead carp. Lovely, lovely times. That didn't take long. Rod's only been out about an hour and I've got myself a nice low 20 common, but I'm keeping my voice down because there's still fish in the swim. Even though this is only a little area that I'm fishing, there's been backs cruising along just over the back there. So just gonna get this one out as quickly as you can and get that rod back out there, because I think there's definitely a chance of another fish. And from what I can see, there's certainly a few bigger fish amongst those that's been cruising around as well. So fingers crossed. Anyway, let's have a look at this one. We've just weighed it and it's weighed in at 26 pounds, so lovely. Absolutely beautiful fish.
Now I'm going to put this one back. I'm not going to put it back in the square pond. I'm going to put it back this side of the lake, just so it doesn't linger in that area, because there's definitely a good chance of another bite or two from that area. There we go. If he wants to get back round to that area, it's got a bit of a swim. The key to success on a lake like this ain't necessarily your baits and your rigs, it's definitely your stealth. And at the moment, we've got fish in the swim. I've just landed one and I've still got carp here. So the last thing I want to do is start thrashing that water to a foam and telling them that I'm here. So I've just got to be very careful about when I redo this rod. There's a group of fish in here. There's only about half a dozen of them. And over there to the right, there is roughly about that sort of figure. So I think I'll be all right to just drop this rod in. And all I'm doing is just fishing to that little hole in the weed. And I'm just going to do it as stealthily and carefully as I can. Ooh, that's perfect. It's gone down lovely. Right, that's all done. So I just need to get out of the swim now and leave the carp to it. With the rod back in position, it was time to sit back and take it all in. However, the evening's action wasn't over just yet, as what happened next was a moment of pure Ashmead magic. Right, one of these rods behind the bivvy has just gone. It's not been out very long either. That looks a nice common. I just need to get the net underneath it, mate. The tip's stuck in the tree and all the line of the tree. Come on, that's a big fish. It looks like a big fish. Yes, yes, oh mate, I've got it. What was all that is? What a fish that is. Oh God, that's gotta be an upper 30. Absolutely made up with that one, brilliant stuff. The magic of Ashmead, I am proper buzzing with that one. So let's take a look at it on the bank. Fantastic, I only just moved that rod as well, so what a result. Oh, that's a good fish, that is. That is a good fish, mate. Don't wait, Bobo. Go out the way. That's a big old fish, that is. That's a lovely old carp. Right, let's get the rig out. Proper magical moment, because that is one of Ashmead's gems. An ounce is short of £40. That is a proper result. Second visit to Ashmead. Came here last year and had a really great time. And if I'm honest, I just knew that this time of year, everything was right for a biggin, and it's felt really good ever since I got here. And there you go, £39, 15 ounces of Ashmead common. Absolutely wonderful. Wow, what a fish. One last look at her. That is absolutely beautiful. What a memory to catch from this fantastic lake. Thank you so much, Ashmead. Thank you to the Carp Society as well. I am proper made up with that, I really am. Almost speechless. I love Ashmead, it's a beautiful venue. So to catch a carp like that is the stuff of dreams. Fantastic stuff. What about that, Bobo? You like that, did you? Eh? Now I've got to get out of this thing. That ain't gonna be easy. Hey, how's that, baby? What a fish.
Well, I certainly wish I was at Ashmead now, looking at these conditions. I'm up north, it's proper grim, and I'm longing for those lovely summer evenings. But I hope you've enjoyed watching this year's Avid Carpers, and I hope you'll join us again next year. Let us know below in the comments what kind of content you'd like to see, and don't forget to like this video and subscribe to the channel for future updates. And I'll catch you again real soon.